Mr. Fox, are you the next witness? Please proceed. And you're going to have to be brief. Ladies and gentlemen, those that are going to speak next are going to have to be very brief in their remarks. This committee is going, this room is going to be used momentarily for another committee, and we do have other matters to attend here, attend to today. So
thank
please
you
proceed.
Thank you for the privilege of testifying. I'd like to ask, before I begin, how many of the members in this room have been to a fracking site of high density in a residential or rural or urban area? Just a show of hands. So none. Well, I would like to invite you to come to Pennsylvania on a tour with myself or any of the residents who are living in an area of high density hydraulic fracturing so that you can see for yourself what it does to a community, what it does to the water quality, what it does to the air quality, and what it does to public health. I have been summoned here today by Illinois People's Action and other grassroots groups to kick off the grassroots tour of Gasland 2 in Illinois because these people have felt that they have been excluded from the process and excluded from their access to democracy in making their voice heard about what will happen to them if their areas become densely fracked. There are many, many layers to this debate, right? There are many layers to examining hydraulic fracturing. The first one, I would say, is from the people themselves. And that is what I have spent the last 5 years of my life doing all across the United States and on four continents to create this film first, Gasland, and I've brought you 10 copies of it so you can take it home and watch it tonight. Because if you haven't been to an area where there's high-dense hydraulic fracturing, you should watch this film because it's the next best thing. I was given the same offer as you were. I was approached to lease my land in Pennsylvania in the upper Delaware, which is right on the border of New York, and allow the fracking industry to come onto my property. And they gave a lot of promises, and many of the things that you've heard here today from the panel so far, with the exception of Sandra Steingraber, is very much in line with the deceptive tactics that the natural gas industry uses when they come on your front porch, and then later when they approach you in the lobby of a state house or on television. The level that I wanted to explore was with the people, the stories that the people were telling, the people who were dealing with this across this nation. And I've interviewed thousands of those people. I can tell you some of their stories. Amy Ellsworth in Colorado, who was showering in the dark because she was afraid that a spark from her light bulb would blow up her bathroom. Her case was confirmed by Colorado Oil and Gas Conservation Commission in Weld County, Colorado, where there are 50,000 operating gas wells, as confirmed contamination of their groundwater with methane from drilling and fracking operations in her area. I could tell you the story of Lisa Parr from Texas, who is surrounded by 21 wells, who the air quality is so bad that she has now fracking chemicals in her lungs. Her and her young daughter and her husband are suffering severe health effects and have had to move out of their home that they built themselves. I can tell you the story of the G family, five generations on the same land in Tioga County, who are now were forced to leave that home because methane from hydraulic fracturing operations and drilling operations just over their property line with a six-well horizontal pad 200 feet from his mother's window. Methane in their groundwater, contaminants from the pad leaking onto their pond, killing off the ecosystem in their pond. They were forced to take a buyout from Shell Corporation, a foreign corporation, and leave their land for five generations. I could tell you of the Ely family, whose water contamination was documented by Pennsylvania Department of Environmental Protection and the EPA, who are now mortgaging their house to pay their legal fees in a battle with Cabot Oil and Gas, one of the largest operators in Pennsylvania. I can tell you the stories of workers, the Bevins family from West Virginia, who lost their son on a well pad in New York, in an industry, as Sandra Steingraber mentioned, that is seven times more likely to kill workers than any other industry in the United States. Or the story of Randy Moyers from Altoona, Pennsylvania, who was asked as a truck driver to clean up mud on a well pad. He wasn't told that that mud was all the toxic fracking chemicals that were used on that site, flowback water, and that he was transporting that water, and that there is an epidemic of sickness. Randy Moyers has lesions all over his body. He can't drive over 55 miles an hour without getting dizzy. He can't spend more than 3 hours playing with his son before getting exhausted. These people's lives are altered beyond repair. I could tell you the story of Bob Howarth, a scientist at Cornell, who's been the subject of ridicule and misinformation of the gas industry, so much so that he has a Google ad placed on his name, because he reported that in the field there was estimates of 3.6 to 7.9 methane leakage out of gas wells, which canceled out any benefit due to climate. Natural gas burns cleaner than coal, but there's enormous quantities of methane escaping into the air, and methane is 105 times more potent a greenhouse gas than carbon dioxide is in the 20-year time frame. Canceling out any benefit to using natural gas over coal, our worst fuel for climate change. That is the people's level of this dialogue. And the people, as you saw standing behind me, have been excluded from this process. There's a scientific level to this process. And I quoted many of these things, of these anecdotal stories that I told you, to show you that these are not anecdotal stories. These are stories that are scientifically supported. In the science, the industry themselves, the Society of Petroleum Engineers, in their most recent PowerPoint on well engineering. Now listen to me. Listen to me. They stated that 35% of the 1.8 million wells in the world are leaking. 35% of those wells currently installed are leaking. The industry admits from their own science, 5% of these cement casings will fail immediately upon drilling, and 50% of them will fail over a 30-year period. That's the industry's own science. That is the industry's own reporting. Pennsylvania Department of Environmental Protection statistics bear this reality out. 6% leakage in 2010. 6% leakage in 2011, and 8.9% leaking gas wells, leaking methane, methane migrating into aquifers, into water supplies, 8.9% for newly installed wells in 2012. This is an industry that cannot be regulated, in my opinion. But then there's another level to this dialogue, and that's the level of politics and PR. What we're hearing, and I would like to submit to you the possibility that the people who are sitting next to me are speaking in the same deceitful language as the natural gas industry. I'm here, I've been asked to come here to report on this as an investigator who I've spent my life for the last 5 years. I have seen this industry run rampant over America, over Americans. I have seen this industry run rampant over people's human and civil rights. Human and civil rights violations cannot be regulated away. If you do not accept my invitation to come to Pennsylvania and see for yourself, you will have the responsibility of putting these people in harm's way. Multinational corporations who are here to exploit resources at the risk and detriment to Americans for their own private profits. And the destruction that will ensue is on everyone's head who decided in some arena of politics and not in an arena of reality that this was going to be all right and that we could come up with rules that are totally morally and scientifically unsupportable. Thank you.
Any further? Now, folks, are you intending